Good afternoon, everybody. I'm glad and honored to present this work on idiosyncratic ideation of smart objects for the home. And this paper is about how to design meaningful and emotionally valuable smart objects together with people in the context of their individual homes. This paper is a collaboration of myself and colleagues from Chemnitz University of Technology, Will Odom from Simon Fraser University in Canada, and Eva Honecker from Bauhaus University in Weimar, Germany. Smart objects for the home, they are a hot topic in design and research, yet as it stands, the IoT for the home produces a lot of pictures from the genre, hold a phone in front of it to make it better. And most IoT for the home, it focuses on efficiency, on comfort, and on security. And there is not much emotional engagement, apart from perhaps when you want to go to bed, but your smart light bulb, it decided it needs a very important firmware update before you can actually switch it off. But other than that, smart objects, they do not spark much emotional engagement. So the question really is, if smart objects, if they rely on so many sensors, why do they suffer from sensory and emotional deprivation? And this is where we set off to explore how to co-design a meaningful and emotionally valuable smart object. There is a huge number of IoT design tools to conduct workshops in order to come up with novel ideas for the smart home, yet none of them focuses on sensory and emotional qualities. And if you look at some of these methods in detail, for example, the note cards on the screen, there are 60 different cards for 60 different sensors and equally many for actuators. Yet the biggest hindrance of these cards is that they fail to engage co-designers in a sensory and emotional way. And one of the reasons for that is that these design tools are analog and request rather a high faculty of abstraction. And we argue in our paper in quite some detail that these tools are quite unfit to make designers and co-designers alike to relate to how a smart object would make them feel, which emotion they might elicit, let alone understand how a specific actuator or a specific sensor actually makes you feel. And that was where we stood in when we built our own co-design tool. It is called Loaded Dice, and it consists of two interactive cubes. And we use this tool to explore the design space of smart connected things together with people. And if you want to try them out, I have them with me down there. Just meet me there. And it consists of two interactive cubes that are wirelessly connected. And one cube, the one to the left, it's a sensor cube, and it has a different sensor in each of its six sides. For example, a temperature sensor, a motion sensor, a volume sensor. And the side that is facing up is active, and it communicates wirelessly with the side facing up on the other cube. So the second cube, you have guessed it, is an actuator cube, and it in turn has a different actuator on each of its six sides, and it reacts to the sensor cube with light, vibration, or with heat. For example, we can detect heat and display it as light, or convert it into air through a fan on the other cube. And we have done quite a number of co-design workshops, and in a number of other papers, we have shown that loaded dice, it supports creativity and exploration skills in the very early stages of design processes. So the question is, if we can use loaded dice to transform heat into air, why can't we use it to, let's say, transform anger into something more objective? And we therefore looked into a prior work at CAI, and among other such vocabularies, we took the one from Diefenbach and colleagues as a start, and they have provided an interaction vocabulary that allows to describe the how of interaction. We took that as a starting point, adapted it quite heavily, and updated it to be fit for describing the interaction with smart objects. So how does this workshop work? It is basically a negotiation. It's relating sensory qualities depicted with a card deck of sensory qualities and functional possibilities of sensors and actuators depicted through loaded dice. And to engage co-designers in workshops, we usually conduct those workshops in the homes of our participants. So in the first step, co-designers, they define a domestic problem that they would like to explore. And in a second step, we support co-designers to explore this problem in depth through the sensory vocabulary. And they also make a distinction between an input and an output side, so to sort sensory qualities into input categories and into output categories. And only then, in a third step, co-designers are introduced to loaded dice, and they use it in order to explore sensors and actuators and to enrich the interaction of actors within this problem space through a connection of loaded dice and the vocabulary. So, for example, they can connect the notion of, let's say, a strange sound sensor with a covered heating element. And we conducted a number of co-design workshops that follow this rationale, and we used it to co-design meaningful and emotionally valuable smart objects in the context of everyday life. Of the smart objects our co-designers came up with, there are three in the paper, and we analyzed those three to understand the role of sensory and emotional qualities in speculating smart objects and services, always together with people in the context of their home. The first one is the anger meter. It was done by a group of co-designers living together, and their next door neighbor often complains that they are making too much noise. So with the anger meter, they can negotiate between their own noise level and the annoyance of their neighbor. So the neighbor can signal the level of his anger with a potentiometer. And to avoid misuse, the device also contains a microphone that compares the subjective anger with the legally allowed noise levels. And with this speculative device, co-designers, they acknowledge their neighbor's issues, yet they reject his anger. And by doing so, the smart object transforms one person's subjective emotion into objective information. Next one is the automated rent debtor. And I will skip that one. It's there's a bit of it in the paper. It's kind of an ethically questionable thing. So I invite you to read about all of that. It's about prohibiting people of having a hot shower when they're late with their rent. So finally, let's talk about cats. This smart object was conceived by a group of co-designers living together in a co-housing project. And the smart object is designed for their three-legged cat, Alfred. And the problem was that the apartment, it has no cat flap. And oftentimes, Alfred the cat, he meows in front of the front door, hoping for someone to let him in. And as this can take any time from 1 minute to 1 hour, especially during night, co-designers, they longed for a remedy they would believe would make their cat happy. So with the help of the card deck, the co-designers described the communication of their cat as poetic, and they decided that a microphone and some animal speech recognition at the front door would recognize the meows of Alfred and distinguish Alfred from any other cat. And co-designers described this as targeted, and to not let Alfred wait, it also needs to be fast. So co-designers also wanted actuation inside the house to be equally poetic, yet also instant and attention-grabbing. And co-designers, they discussed the notion of poetic IoT quite strongly, and they figured if they amplify the meowing through a loudspeaker, they would still be Alfred, but loud and thus unpoetic. They also considered having Shakespeare poems being read aloud, also unpoetic. And CoDesigners then switched to loaded dies, and they explored sensors and actuators through actual functionality. And their final poetic idea is a fan instead of a loudspeaker. This does not disturb conversation through an unpoetic sound, but still it's grabbing attention. So when Alfred meows at the door, an inflatable but larger copy of himself would be inflated by a fan, then rise to the ceiling and shake. And this inflated cat, it would be located in a resident's bedroom and would only be triggered by the meowing of Alfred, but not any other cat. So what should you take from this? Our workshop design, it allowed co-designers to reflect on how sensory information should be transformed into actuation. And in this example, a poetic and targeted interaction was transformed into a completely different poetic notion that was still friendly and attention-grabbing. So our workshops enabled people to develop their own ideas and concepts for what an IoT artifact might be in the context of their home. And I could now send you home quite happily and invite you to build one of these objects for next Tai or Kai. But these objects are not necessarily what we want you to build. These smart objects, they are idiosyncratic in the sense that the ideas are highly poetic and emotionally valuable, but only make sense in a specific housing context. And in exploring those with our workshops, the examples, they unravel how idiosyncratic smart objects mirror the housing situation that the co-designers are living in. And our workshops, they also enabled co-designers to ideate emotionally valuable smart objects. They do not build on objective measurements towards efficient communication, but they rely on situated knowledge of the people involved to imagine emotionally valuable communication. And the anger meter, for example, it makes only sense in the context of an old neighbor's need for rest and a younger party crowd living next door. So with future work, we need to focus on reflecting on the home, on more non-stereotypical homes through the idiosyncrasies of the smart objects individually created for them. More importantly, how did the workshop enable co-designers to ideate smart objects that foregrounded these particular sensory and emotional qualities? This was possible through a back-and-forth process with a lot of reflection and exploration of sensory attributes on one side and functional possibilities on the other side. So in a first phase, the sensory vocabulary allowed co-designers to frame relevant issues from their homes in a self-determined way. And here the cards, they helped co-designers to empathize with absent people, with their angry neighbor, or with their cat. And only then, in a second phase, co-designers considered issues of functionality and their attributed emotional qualities, such as anger or poetics, into functional attributes of sensors embodied in loaded dies. But more importantly, there was always a back channel of negotiating sensory attributes and functional sensors and actuators. And only this back and forth between these tools allowed to fine-tune the translation of sense and emotion and to translate sensory and emotional qualities into objective input or objective output. So to sum up, by exploring sensory and emotional properties, by alternating between sensory vocabulary and technical toolkit, co-designers translated between what it would mean for an interaction to be poetic and meaningful, and only then to make a creative negotiation and to attribute functional properties to an actuator. And in doing so, it becomes meaningful for the residents that a fan-inflated cat communicates the need of an actual cat in a poetic way. And these findings now, they raise a number of questions for the HCI community. For example, how can HCI design further support these small but crucial back and forth steps between translating sensory perception to emotion and vice versa? And there's also a need for future work for a detailed investigation on how the sensory and emotional qualities of smart objects relate. And with that, I'm taking your questions.
Hi, Gregory Abaud. I want to thank you for a thought-provoking talk. I'm going to ask, I have a lot of questions, but the one I'm going to ask is a kind of from an engineering perspective to a designer. One thing that I'm skeptical about in what you presented here is that that vocabulary that you gave to describe the input and output actually led to the ideas that these creative designers came up with. So what evidence do you have that those people, if even if they didn't have the vocabulary you gave them, would, you know, whether they would have come up with these ideas? Because I'm trying to think, I would like to be creative like this. It's not clear to me that those words that you give me are going to help me make the leap to coming up with an inflatable cat idea.
Well, there's definitely no evidence of that. So I certainly can't promise you that your co-designers will be as creative as our co-designers. And we did just not as enough workshops to actually know that. But from me as a designer asking an engineer, the question is, how could we help co-designers to build those very idiosyncratic ideas just for their home, and not for like building more stuff that can be sold like by the thousands, so that people might in the end be able to ideate in their home on their own,
right,
yet building things that are meaningful for them.
Yeah, I mean, because, for example, that cat, great idea, but the failing I see with that is you have to, you know, what range within the home is going to communicate that the cat wants to get in, right? If it's in the bedroom and I'm in the kitchen, I won't see it. Poor cat. That's a very utilitarian perspective on that, even though it's a clever idea.
Yes.